Inside the cast iron fence that surrounds the Riverside Oval, a tiny park near the western end of 156th Street, is a low granite octagon, maybe 20 feet across and a foot and a half high. A neighborhood volunteer group, the Riverside Oval Association, stores gardening paraphernalia inside it. But sometime after the park was created, a little more than a century ago, the octagon enclosed a fountain, which was designed to feature a statue of a cherub and a mermaid, called Music of the Waters. The sculptor's model for the mermaid was Audrey Munson. Keep watching to know the tragedy of America's supermodel. Audrey Mary Munson, born on June 8, 1891, was an American artist, model, and a film actress today considered America's first supermodel. In her time, she was variously known as Miss Manhattan, the Panama Pacific Girl, the Exposition Girl, and America's Venus. She was the model or inspiration for more than 12 statues in New York City and many others elsewhere. Munson was also the first American actress to appear fully nude in film. In Inspiration, 1915, the first of her four silent films. Audrey Mary Munson was born in Rochester, New York on June 8, 1891, to Edgar Munson and Catherine Katie Mahaney. Her father was from Mexico, New York, and she later lived there. Her parents divorced when she was 8, and Audrey and her mother moved to Providence, Rhode Island. In 1909, the pair moved to New York City, where the 17-year-old Audrey sought a career as an actress and chorus girl. Her first role on Broadway was as footman in The Boy and the Girl at the Ariel Gardens of the New Amsterdam Theatre, which ran from May 31 to June 19, 1909. She also appeared in The Girl and the Wizard, Girlies, and La Belle Paris. While window shopping on Fifth Avenue with her mother, she was spotted by photographer Felix Benedict Herzog, who asked her to pose for him at the studio in the Lincoln Arcade building on Broadway and 65th Street. Herzog introduced her to his friends in the art world. She posed for muralist William Declift Dodge, who gave her a letter of introduction to Isidore Conti. Conti was her first sculptor and her first nude modeling. From this point, Munson would pose for a few well-known visual artists, including painter Francis Coates Jones, illustrators Harrison Fisher, Archie Gunn, and Charles Dana Gibson, and photographers Herzog and Arnold Genthy. But she was predominantly a sculptor's model. Munson's first acknowledged credit in Conti's marble statuary, called Three Graces, unveiled in the new Grand Ballroom at the Hotel Astor in Times Square in September 1909. She posed for all three graces. Soon after, and for the next decade, Munson became the model of choice for the first tier of American sculptors, posing for a long list of freestanding statuary, monuments, and allegorical architectural sculpture on state capitals and other major public buildings. According to The Sun in 1913, over 100 artists agree that if the name Miss Manhattan belongs to anyone in particular, it is to this young woman. By 1915, she was so well established that she became Alexander Sterling Cadler's model of choice. When he became director of sculpture for the Panama Pacific International Exposition held in San Francisco that year, her figure was 90 times repeated against the sky. On one building alone, atop the colonnades of the Court of the Universe, roughly modeled on St. Peter's Square in the Vatican. In fact, Munson posed for 3/5 of the sculpture created for the event and earned fame as the Panama Pacific Girl. Munson's newfound celebrity helped launch her career in the nascent film industry, and she starred in four silent films. In the first, Inspiration, 1915, the story of a sculptor's model, she appeared fully nude. the first woman to do so in an American motion picture. The censors were reluctant to ban the film, fearing they would also have to ban Renaissance art. Munson's films were a box office success, although the critics were divided. The studio hired a lookalike named Jane Thomas to do Munson's acting scenes, while Munson did the scenes where she posed nude. Her second film, Purity, in 1916, made in Santa Barbara, California, is the only one of her films to survive, being rediscovered in 1993 in a pornographic collection in France and acquired by the French National Cinema Archive. Her third film, The Girl of Dreams, also made in Santa Barbara, was completed by the fall of 1916 and copyrighted on December 31, 1918. But appears never to have been released. Munson returned to the East Coast by train via Syracuse in December 1916, having been involved with high society in New York and Newport, Rhode Island. There are accounts where her mother insists she marries the son of Comstock Lord, silver-haired Herman Ulrichs Jr., then the richest bachelor in America. There is no record of this. On January 27, 1919, she wrote a rambling letter to the U.S. State Department denouncing Ulrichs as part of the pro-German network that had driven her out of the movie business. She said she planned to abandon the United States to restart her movie career in England. In 1919, Audrey Munson was living with her mother in a boarding house at 164 West 65th Street, Manhattan, owned by Dr. Walter Wilkins. Wilkins fell in love with Munson and on February 27th murdered his wife Julia so he could be available for marriage. Munson and her mother left New York and the police sought them for questioning. After a nationwide hunt, they were located. They refused to return to New York but were questioned by agents from the Burns Detective Agency in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. The contents of the affidavits they supplied had never been revealed, but Audrey Munson strongly denied she had any romantic relationship with Dr. Wilkins. Wilkins was tried, found guilty, and sentenced to the electric chair. He hanged himself in his prison cell before the sentence could be carried out. As a direct consequence or not, the Wilkins killing marked the end of Munson's 10-year modeling career. She continued to seek regular newspaper coverage. By 1920, Munson, unable to find work anywhere, was reported as living in Syracuse, New York, supported by her mother, who sold kitchen utensils door-to-door. In November 1920, she was said to be working as a ticket taker in a dime museum. From January through May 1921, a series of 20 serialized articles ran in Hearst's Sunday magazine in dozens of Sunday newspaper supplements. Under Munson's name, the whole series entitled By the Queen of Artists Studios. The 20 articles relate anecdotes from her career with warnings about the fates of other models. In one, she asked the reader to imagine her future. What becomes of the artist's models? I am wondering if many of my readers have not stood before a masterpiece of lovely sculpture or a remarkable painting of a young girl. Her very abandonment of draperies, accentuating rather than diminishing her modesty and purity, and asked themselves the question, where is she now, this model who was so beautiful? In February that year, agent producer Alan Rock took out advertisement showing a $27,500 check he had said he had paid Munson to star in a fourth film titled Heedless Moths, based on these writings. She later said that $27,500 check was just a publicity stunt and she filed suit case against Alan Rock. These proceedings revealed that the 20 articles had been ghostwritten by journalist Henry Layford Gates. In the summer of 1921, Munson conducted a nationwide search carried by the United Press for the perfect man to marry. She ended the search in August, claiming that she did not want to get married anyway, On October 3, 1921, she was arrested at the Royal Theatre, later the Town Theatre, in St. Louis on a moral charge related to her personal appearance with the film Innocence, in which she had a leading role. She and her manager, independent film producer Ben Jurel, were both acquitted. Weeks later, she was still appearing in St. Louis, along with screenings of Innocence, enacting a series of new poses from famous paintings. On May 27, 1922, Munson attempted suicide by swallowing a solution of bichloride of mercury. On June 8, 1931, her mother petitioned a judge to commit her to a lunatic asylum. The Oswego County judge ordered Munson to be admitted into a psychiatrist facility for treatment. She remained in the St. Lawrence State Hospital for the Insane in Ogdensburg, where she was treated for depression and schizophrenia for 65 years until her death at the age of 104. In the mid of 1950s, Munson was sufficiently famous to serve as the subject of an anecdote in a memorial that P.G. Woodhouse and Guy Bolton wrote of their years on Broadway, Bring on the Girls, 1953. Though the memorial is considered more fiction than fact by Woodhouse biographer. For decades, she had no visitors at the asylum, but she was rediscovered there by a half-niece, Darlene Bradley, in 1984. When Munson was 93. Several years after suffering a stroke, Munson died on February 20, 1996 at the age of 104. She was buried without a gravestone of her own in the Munson family plot in New Haven Cemetery, New Haven, New York. In 2016, 20 years after her death, her family decided to add a simple tombstone for what would have been her 125th birthday.